50, if no one else. Number 50. Number 50. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
325. Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above.
Calvary.
349. 227.
Get it from the horse.
You may sing of the beauty of mountain and hill, of the silvery stream where the flowers of the vale, but the place of delight all this earth can afford is the place of devotion, the house of the
Lord, certainly on behalf of Bear Creek Church, we would like to welcome all of you to our services here tonight. I am just overwhelmed with joy with this large number of people who have come out tonight. Blessed kindred in Christ Jesus, gathered together to worship the Lord once again. Very thankful for this special fifth weekend meeting that Bear Creek Church has been granted to host this. So we're so grateful, and I'm trusting that we all have been prayerful for this meeting time. We give a special welcome to our guest ministers tonight. They're home ministers, but we do not get to hear them too often due to some distance that they live away and obligations to churches that they are blessed to serve. Elder Michael Gowens and Elder Steve Nichols, so very thankful for them. I believe Brother Steve's going to be with us the whole weekend. Brother Michael's going to be with us through tomorrow. He will have to be back to Bethel for the services on Sunday there. So we're very thankful for these brethren, and we're praying that the Lord will bless them tonight. Also thankful for home ministers and others that are with us, Elder David Anderson. We have asked him, he would open our service with prayer tonight. Also very thankful for Brother James Carrollock, Brother Wayne Gradley. Is any others here tonight, ministering brethren? So thankful to have them with us tonight as well. We'll go through our list, and I'm sad to say it's very long, but we know that it's not beyond the Lord's ability to meet the needs. The long list of prayer requests that we have for loved ones, that we will go through those tomorrow. But I will ask if there's any special prayer requests tonight. Yes, sir. Yes, yes, thank you, Brother Kim. We want to remember Brother Ned Honeycutt. He's back in the hospital again. I assume he's still there. And so we want to remember him in our prayers. He's been through a whole lot over a long period of time.
Brother Rich.
Yes.
We need to make mention of our sister Jean Hogan. It's in the hospital at Ashburn, in the nursing home at Ashburn. I just found out she was at Ashburn. I thought she was at Salisbury, but she's at Ashburn. We need to remember her. She lost her husband, Brother Gene Hogan, Elder Gene Hogan. She lost him a while back, and she's been having a lot of trouble since.
Yes, thank you, Brother Dave. We want to certainly continue to remember Sister Gene Hogan in our prayers. I did get a report that she is improving. She is still there in that rehab nursing center. So let's please remember her. Any other special prayer requests? Most certainly we want to remember, and I'm going to word it like this if I might be allowed to do it. We certainly want to remember the innocent that is involved in the war there in Israel and Palestine issues there with those folks, Hamas. This is a terrible situation over there. I've been following in some of the news. I assume that some of you have too. And so I feel so sad for those that are the innocent, and may God bless them and protect them until this war would end. There be no other prayer requests. We'll ask an opening hymn. You have one, Brother Tim. Yes.
Number 20, first to last.
Yes. Yes, let's please remember those that lost their lives in that terrible shooting in the state of Maine. Let's please remember that. After we sing, we'll ask Brother David to come and pray for us, and we're going to begin tonight with Brother Steve Nichols. And Brother Michael will follow him. So please be praying for these brethren.
Number 20, first and last.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us, son.
Seems like your saying is awful short to me today. It got over too fast. Let us bow. Our most kind, merciful Heavenly Father, we come to Thee and realize that we can acquaint Thee with nothing. Thou knoweth all things, worketh all things after the counsel of Thine own will, doing Thy pleasure in the army of heaven and amongst the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay Thy hand, nor say, Jehovah, what doeth Thou? Realizing, dear Lord, that we need Thee continuously, Thou being our strength, Thou being the enlightening of our understanding, Thou being the one that has made us, Thou being the one that has brought us safe thus far, and only by Thy grace shall we deliver home some sweet day to be with Thee, like Thee, and satisfied. Thou art altogether lovely, giving us a hunger within ourselves, as Thou hast promised us to be conformed to the image of Thy dear Son, realizing, dear Lord, that we too, by Thy grace, shall be altogether lovely and no darkness in it all, us at all. We rejoice and we call on Thee to draw us near. Keep us at our brother's feet. Strengthen us, dear Lord, as we press on and march on toward the prize of the mark of the high calling. Strengthen us that we might stand high and cry loud and spare not, even as our dear Apostle Paul said, I declare to preach the whole counsel of God. Bless these brethren tonight, dear Lord, as Thou puts it on their heart and their soul, that they might come forth with those things, that Thou would have them to speak, knowing that Thou knowest what this waiting congregation needs. Dear Lord, help us to speak the things that is pleasing unto Thee, that the flesh might be chastened, reproved, and rebuked, that it might walk in the straight and the narrow way that leadeth to life everlasting. Lord, Thou knowest what we need, and we call on Thee to furnish those things what we need. If it be trials, if it be tribulation, if it be sorrow, if it be pain, Lord, Thou knowest. We rejoice in Thee and realize, dear Lord, that Thou can teach and none can hinder, Thou can work and none can hinder, Thou can hinder and none can work. And dear Lord, if this attempt to pray unto Thee has any benefit, it comes from Thee and it returns unto Thee through the hearts and the souls of Thy people. And as Thou tells us in Thy word, he that begin a good word in us shall perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Lord, we are at Thy mercy, and we thank Thee that Thou hast had mercy and compassion on us to this day. And dear Lord, as we fight a good fight of faith, realizing that we fight not flesh and blood, but principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places, knowing no other place higher than in thy gathered communion of the saints, realizing there's no place higher, we call on us to strengthen us and to listen to Thy precepts and hold on to those things that Thou teaches us in Thy word, realizing as Thy only Son has said unto us, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Lord, continue with us, we bless. We beg, continue with us and help us be what Thou would have us to be. Lord, keep us in the straight and in our way. Help us ever look to Thee, the author and the finisher of our faith. We thank Thee in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I know there's a big clock back there, but I'm not used to looking that way. And I don't know if I can see that far, even if it is that big. Some of y'all might understand that, right? Appreciate the privilege of being here. And it is a privilege to be in the Lord's house. We are thankful to have the invitation. And we're thankful that the Lord's blessed us to come. And I feel like I've already been blessed. I know many have been praying. I trust that the Lord has heard the prayers of the saints of God and will pour out his spirit upon this service this weekend. I'd like to commend the church here at Bear Creek just briefly. It speaks well when you drive up to a meeting house and the grounds are clean and the building is well kept and neat and repaired and tidy. It says there's a people that care. So it speaks well. I commend you for your labors and efforts. I want to speak to you tonight, some, and I say some, because there's no way to finish it tonight, probably not tomorrow, Sunday, or maybe 2 or 3 weeks from now. But if the Lord blesses and we just speak on 4 or 5 verses or 10 or 15, and his name is honored and glorified and his children are edified, then it's worthwhile. And if I don't finish on what I'd like to, then y'all are very capable of reading and studying it on your own. I want to speak on the book of Jonah. The book of Jonah. It's a short book. I got a pretty big print here. It's about 3 pages in my book. But if you got a little print, it might be 1 or 1.5. So it's very readable. All right. It is also very understandable. There are many doctrinal teachings in the book of Jonah, and there are many practical lessons for God's children in the book of Jonah. It's a fascinating story. I guess every child grew up, you know, with Daniel in the lion's den and Jonah and maybe some of David and a few other writings in the scriptures that were favorites for them. But I don't care if you're 5 or 105, it's a very profitable book. Those that deny the Bible, the Lord, the inspiration of Scripture, the existence of a God, they complain about this book, but they complain about the whole Bible. All right? And they're always trying to say, well, this couldn't happen, and that couldn't happen, and that couldn't be done, and that's beyond the realm of nature, and that doesn't work that way in the physical world. What they don't realize is that the Almighty God of heaven has all power and can do all things for God's child. I have no difficulty with this. Parting of the Red Sea, the Lord Jesus Christ rising on the 3rd of the following morning, doesn't matter. All things are possible through God. It says, and I find it of note, and maybe I should go ahead and do that. I find it, and it's interesting, very little first is said about Jonah himself. 2 Kings 14, there's about one verse, around verse 25, that mentions him briefly, that he is a prophet, and he made some prophecies about some of the restoration of the kingdom under the time of the second King Jeroboam in Israel. And then this book is authorship, and then he's mentioned in the New Testament by the Lord Jesus Christ. And that mention of Christ in the New Testament, and it's in 2 places, but I'll read one in Matthew 12. Is a critical text. Right? Much of the Christian world missed it and still miss it. Okay? Much of the Christian world today, even the most knowledgeable and the most instructed in whatever schools they've been to and whatever teachers they had of a worldly kind, I would trust have at least read the scriptures, but still can't see what it says. All right? And the Lord quoted from Jonah. That's proof enough to me that it's accurate and real. All right. In other words, when I say real, what took place, took place.
Right.
All right. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 38, it says, then certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee. That generation continually made that request. They wanted to see a miracle from Christ. Thing is, he'd already shown them many. They still didn't believe.
Right.
It will show more. They still won't believe.
But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation. That's what the Lord Jesus Christ called those people in that day, living at that time when he was standing there preaching to them then. I wonder what he called ours. Probably somewhere I would expect. An evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given it, or to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. He did not say 3 piece-of-days.
Right.
He didn't say a day, a half a day, and a part of day.
Right.
He said very clearly in language that cannot be misunderstood unless you try. Right. As Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights, he made sure he covered a whole 24-hour period. Jonas, 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the whale. The Son of Man shall be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth, proving without a doubt. And if you'll just go, and I'm not going to turn there tonight. If you, somebody can't find the one, I'll give it to you tomorrow. Maybe. If you go to like the end of Matthew's gospel, the disciples early on the first day of the week came to the tomb, and Christ had risen already. As soon as it was light, they were there. So we know the Lord rose on the first day of the week. If you back up 3 days, you cannot wind up on Friday. I don't care what kind of new math they're teaching, it won't work.
Right.
Okay? The Lord was crucified on Wednesday and died right before sundown, which ended that Jewish day.
Right.
I preached about 7 or 8 or 10 Sundays on that whole subject, but you got to go through too much. Proving what day the Lord died on. But those two verses here, and when the disciples showed up at the tomb, tell you the Lord died on Wednesday, just before sundown. They spent all day Thursday, all day Friday, all day Saturday in the tomb, and rose early. He was already up when the disciples came to the tomb. And he says, the men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation. Why? They'll condemn it. Why? Because they repented at the preaching of Jonas, and behold, a greater than Jonas is here. Now to the book of Jonah, chapter 1. The word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it. That means preach or prophesy. Speak the words I will give you. Cry against it. Tell them what I'm going to tell you to speak to them. For their wickedness has come up before me. The Lord knows and understands all things that are going on. Nothing surprises him, and nothing escapes his knowledge. And he states to Jonah, the word comes to Jonah, and he tells Jonah, the wickedness of Nineveh is before my eyes. The wickedness of the world today is before God's eyes too. Okay? He sees. Try to choose my words more and more carefully. When I can say something a little bit off, somebody can be confused, didn't understand what I meant, go away, totally lost. I don't like that. I am surprised at how many of God's children are so weak in spiritual knowledge and understanding in this day and time. Thank you all. All right. Thank you, brother. Weak in this day and time. Many so-called or professed Christian people would say, well, where's God right now? Brother Richard mentioned the war in the Middle East. There's one been going on for a year and a half in Europe. There's probably a half a dozen more going on in little countries around the world all the time. Very few days in the history of the world have been without warfare.
Right.
And these so-called professors and Christian folks will say, well, where's God with all this going on? He's in charge, and he sees it all, and he knows it all. And they say, well, look at all this mess. It's man's mess. God didn't send this. Sin brought all this. The answer to it is God's mercy.
Right.
And men have proven they can fix it. I told the church either last Sunday or the Sunday before, because I think it's been 2 weeks now. I said, people say, well, they've been fighting in the Middle East for about 75 years. I said, no, they've been fighting for about 3,500.
Yeah.
They took a pause for a while after AD 70 when they were dispersed to the world, but they've been fighting each other for 3,500 years.
Yeah.
If men could solve it, I think they'd have figured it out by now. The Lord tells Jonah a specific place to go to. And he's going to give him a specific and definite message for those people. Because of their wickedness. This book, besides its historical and doctrinal perspective, is also a great example and foretelling of God's coming mercy to the Gentiles.
Yes, it is.
Nineveh was not a city in Israel or Judah. Nineveh was a city of the Assyrian Empire at this point. Sometime about 775 to 800 years BC, somewhere in there. I don't like to get too specific anymore because you can read one historian that says this day, one of 10 that years that way. About that far, about 800 BC. Was not a Jewish community. Totally pagan, heathen, God-denying, false idol-worshiping people. But it is a foretelling that in the days to come, God will send His mercy to the Gentiles.
Yeah.
The Jews, they miss that story too, by and large.
Right.
The children of Israel have read the book of Jonah, but failed to realize that the people spoken to were Gentiles. The message wasn't going to Jerusalem or Nazareth, Nineveh. I like it when God makes His will clear in my life. I don't like vagueness, Sister Nancy. I can get confused real easy. I like God to be plain and clear with me. Okay? Because I'm dense and slow, and the older I get, slower I get. Alright? So I like it plain and clear. Jonah got a plain, clear message. Go here. Go here. But Jonah is a whole lot like a lot of the Lord's children.
Right.
We say we want to know what the Lord tells us, but when He tells us, we don't listen, we go the other direction. Right? Well, Lord, lead me. Well, Lord, I don't want to go that way.
Right.
I'll go this way.
Yeah.
I mean, isn't that our nature? That's our human nature, is it not?
It is.
Jonah got a clear message. Jonah, go to Nineveh. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. One of those good doctrinal points. He thought he was going to get away from the presence of God. You can't do it.
That's right.
He couldn't sail far enough to get away from God's presence. But he thought he could. He thought, if I just get on a ship and I sail just far enough, the Lord won't be there. He can't find me. He won't know what's going on. No one won't know where I am. I can do what I want to until He forgets about this and it blows over. You cannot flee from the presence of God. Wherever you go, God is already there. Okay? But Jonah sets out to flee, and he went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish, again stating from the presence of the Lord. So he says, I think I'll go down to this city of Tarshish. I've heard about it. You know, maybe they've got nice food down there, and you know, they got good places to stay, and the weather's good, and wonderful this time of year, I'll go down there. And he goes and buys him a ticket to this city, and he gets on this boat. And they're going to sail away there. And I can imagine what Jonah's thinking right about the time he steps on there. That worked out pretty good. That's going well so far. A lot of God's children go down that same pathway in their lives.
Right.
Brothers and sisters, we can make decisions all along our journey of life that once we make that turn will affect us for years afterwards. Amen. And it might look pretty good to start with, but years later we may look back and say, well, you know, right there I took the wrong turn. Lord tried to tell me, but I wouldn't listen. And John thinks he's got it made. But the Lord,
yeah.
He's still there. He's still there tonight. Okay? God is still there. He hasn't gone anywhere. He has not grown any tired. He's not gotten any forgetful. He's not lost any power. He's not gotten a little dull. He's there, all powerful, all knowing, all wise, all the time. But the Lord sent out a great wind into the sea. A lot of people read that and say, well, then every time the wind blows, God made it. No. Much of the world's physical functioning systems function under the rules God set it up under to start with, but affected by sin. You understand that? What God set up to begin with was perfect. Perfect weather. Folks didn't need any air conditioning. When Adam and Eve were in the garden, no mosquitoes. If they were there, they didn't bite. Don't know what they did then, but they weren't bothering them. You got to wonder sometimes, you know, what was God thinking when he did this? Maybe one day if I have any sense, when I get over there, I might ask him, but I doubt it ain't on that. But you look at some of the things in the world and you say, well, you know, the Lord had a purpose for that, but I sure don't see it. But he's far wiser than all of us.
Amen.
Didn't rain for hundreds of years. Okay? Perfect. But when God wants to, he can providentially use any means he so desires in dealing with his children, including controlling the wind and weather. So don't think every time a storm comes, well, God sent that one. No, it's just a functioning many times of the earth, cursed though with sin, the way God set it up, but decaying. Sent out a great wind into the sea, and there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. I've never been a person that cared a whole lot about the ocean. It's beautiful, but it's just not my place. And I don't need to sail on it or anything else. It's marvelous. It's wonderful. It's fascinating, but it's just not mine. But Jonah is on a ship, as we will find out in detail a little later here, with men that are experienced. These aren't a bunch of weekend sailors. They sail for a living. They've been in storms before. They've seen problems before. They're not newcomers to this. And this storm was powerful. So that it seemed like from the very beginning the ship was going to be broken apart. Well, it seems like a lot of times in our lives that it's just going to be broken apart. You ever feel like your life's just coming undone? The storms are too great? Problems are too many, too numerous, too quick, coming apart. Same answer that solves Jonah's problem solves ours. The grace and mercy of Almighty God. Then the mariners were afraid. I said, these are seasoned men. They know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. They're scared. And cried every man unto his God. That's what they do first. These were not a bunch of Hebrew sailors. To start with, when they're fearful, they pray to their gods. Each man might have had 4, 5, or 10. But he probably had a certain one or two that were special. But he might have, each sailor on there may have had multiple gods. They're all praying to their God. Not the God, but their God. And they cried every man unto his God, and cast the wares that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it of them. That shows real fear. Those goods on that ship are vital to their livelihood. All right? It'd be like a farmer going out and harvesting up all of his grain, stick it in the silo, and set fire to it. It's going to be gone. That's what he needed. Okay, that's his income. Well, these wares on this ship are their income. They're to deliver this cargo, deliver this goods,
right,
deliver the passengers, if there are those on there like John. They're very afraid. They're throwing everything overboard. Where's old Jonah? He's so comfortable with his plan. Okay? Jonah's plan. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep.
Right.
Like I said, he's thinking, this plan's going real well.
Right.
And Jonah goes down in this ship, and the storm's just raging. But he's so satisfied and at peace and calm, and he's asleep. And so the shipmaster came to him and said unto him, what meanest thou, O sleeper? A lot of God's children are asleep. They need to be woken up.
Yeah.
Brother Michael, I'll kind of paraphrase what you said at the association. You talked about the preaching committee making maybe a mistake on Sunday. I agree with you. These brethren here may think they made a mistake before we leave this weekend, or I leave this weekend, if I put that way. They'll probably say, I don't know who invited that guy, but don't ask you back. A lot of God's children are asleep and need to be woken up. Brethren, preacher brethren, we do not have time left in our lives and ministry just to dance around the edges. We just got to be plain and hard and simple.
Right.
We ain't got the time, and God's children don't either. It's too short. Arise, call upon thy God. They've already prayed to all theirs, nothing happened. Surprise there, no surprise whatsoever. You can pray to every rock, stick, statue, sun, moon, whatever else you want to, as long as you want to. It will do no good. They'd all pray to their gods, no effect. So they say, Jonah, wake up and pray to your God. Maybe he's the right one. If so be that God will think upon us that we perish not. And they said, every one to his fellow, come, let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this evil is upon us. Common practice in that day. Commonly done in that day as a method or means whereby they would prove a question, prove a point, prove a fact, try to find an answer. Cast lots. Referenced many times in Scripture. So they said, let's get together, cast lots, and see who's responsible for this. Got to be somebody's fault, right? That is the theme of our day and time. Got to be somebody's fault. Can't be mine. Got to be somebody's fault.
Yes.
Okay. Anything goes wrong, well, it wasn't my fault. Mama and daddy didn't give me the bicycle I wanted. It's their fault. I didn't go to the right school when I grew up, or I didn't get this, or I didn't get that. Not my fault, somebody else's fault. No, it's yours. Always in the end comes back right here. Our problems are our fault. What is thine occupation? Whence comest thou? What is thy country? And of what people art thou? They got a bunch of questions. And they want to know. What do you do? Where are you from? What people are you with? Why did you come this way? And Jonah answered and said, I am a Hebrew. I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. But a powerful doctrinal lesson. God created it all. Okay? Maybe in public education, the theory of evolution has won the battle. But in the hearts, homes, and congregations of God's people, they have not.
Amen. Amen.
Okay? So the war ain't over. The God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land, then were the men exceedingly afraid. Because they believed what he said. They said, oh, this man's God is the real creator. He's the real thing. And then they said, why hast thou done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. Good question. Jonah, why did you do this?
Yes.
You ever ask yourself, why did I do that after you've done it? Why did I do that? I do that a lot. Steve, why did you do that? Because you're dumber than you were yesterday. It's the only answer I got. You get worse every day, brother, not better. That's me. I tell myself that every day. Proves evolution is a lie. I ain't getting no better. How about you folks? No, that's right. The more I know about myself every day, the more I realize just how, according to him, poor, weak, and worthless I am.
Amen.
Then they said to him, what shall we do unto thee that the sea may be calm to us? For the sea was wroth and was tempestuous. And he said to them, take me up, cast me into the sea. And so shall the sea be calm to you, for I know that for my sake this great tempest is upon you. Another great point. In our humanistic, self-serving, self-centered era, the world is telling everyone and trying to especially indoctrinate our young folks that you can do whatever you want, it just affects you. So go right ahead. In other words, if it feels good, do it. What Jonah said was, is you are all in this peril because of me.
Right.
Sounded like his sin had repercussions, didn't it?
Right.
That's all over the Bible.
Yes, sir.
You remember when David numbered Israel? Man, there was some fallout from that, wasn't there?
Yeah.
Don't tell me that when you sin, it just affects you. It can have far-reaching effects. And long term, Jonah says, for me are you in this peril, for my sin. And he gave him the remedy. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to land, but they could not, for the sea was wroth and tempestuous against them. Wherefore they cried unto the Lord and says, now who do they pray to now? Did you catch that when I ran by there? Before they were praying to their gods. Now, they say, oh Lord, we beseech thee.
Right.
Conversion doesn't take 20 years.
Amen.
Now, they were not ready to stand up and defend election and predestination and all those things, but they knew who God was. That's the foundation for everything else. Lord, we beseech thee, let us not perish for this man's life. Lay not upon us his innocent blood, for thou, O Lord, hast done as it pleased thee. Another wonderful point. The Lord does exactly what he wants according to his pleasure, when he wants and how he wants, period. Does that mean sometimes he chastens his children? Absolutely, he does. But it's for our benefit. To get us back in the right pathway. If he just let us go, we'd go straight to destruction in no time. I fixed it quick with my. So they took up Jonah and cast him into the sea, and the sea ceased from raging. Most violent storm they'd ever seen, they cast Jonah overboard. Instantly, it's calm. Didn't take a week or two to blow by. Instantly, calm. That's God's power. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly. They were even more fearful of God now. They've passed the fear of the storm. They're more fearful of God. They see God's power.
Right.
They have never seen this happen before. A storm raging and then instantaneous calm. That'll get your attention. They offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. Doesn't say what they vowed. I can kind of imagine. I'll leave that to you. They made promises. Hope they kept them. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. Here it says fish. Jesus said whale. I don't care if it was a tadpole. Do you? Or a lobster or a shrimp. Because why? God prepared it. That's all that matters. God prepared it. That means he made it capable of doing what he wanted it to do. He prepared it. Okay? You know, and biologists will say, well, a whale can't swallow a man. He can if God prepared it. Whales don't normally go into that part of the Mediterranean. There was one there that day.
Right.
God prepared it. See, we have a tendency as human beings to quit looking up and bring God down here. In other words, make him like us.
Right.
But he's so far above us, brothers and sisters, we can't begin to comprehend.
Amen.
The Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish. How long? 3 days and three nights. May God bless you is my prayer. I appreciate your attention. Come on.
Here in the vineyard of my Lord, I love to live and labor and be obedient to my God until my dying hour. I love to sing while lilies grow.
Nichols' comments from the book of Jonah, and it's evident that he's meditated and studied in that book, and I appreciate very much what he said. Look forward to hearing the the sequel, part two, tomorrow, if the Lord so directs. I don't want to darken counsel and cause you to forget what you've heard, but I do feel directed to the Gospel of John in the New Testament. If you have a Bible, I invite you to join me there. In the third and the fourth chapters, and we have three particular scenes in John chapters 3 and 4. We have the visit by Nicodemus to Jesus by night. Then we have John the Baptist's response to his disciples who told him that Jesus was threatening his popularity. And then we have in John chapter 4, Jesus going through Samaria for the express purpose of encountering the Samaritan woman. But interestingly, as we look at this narrative in these two chapters, there are four musts, M-U-S-T-S, the word must in these chapters in John's gospel. And I want to focus for a few moments tonight on John's four musts. Now, the word must speaks of a logical necessity. It's necessary. It's essential. It's absolutely crucial. Must. It's the strongest verb in the English language, probably the strongest verb in the Greek language, in all languages, must. It's different than I might, I want to, I desire. It's different than I should, must. And the first time that we encounter this word is in John chapter 3, verse 7, where Jesus says, "Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again." Now, this comes in the visit from Nicodemus, in the narrative of Nicodemus's visit to Jesus. And I want to backtrack just a moment to the first verse in John chapter 3 to get the background. We read, "There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews." Now, we're told two things about him besides his name in this verse. First of all, he's a religious man. He's a Pharisee. The Pharisees were the theologians, the Bible scholars of the people. So he's very religious. He's meticulous in keeping the law, and he's serious about serving God. He's a Pharisee. Not only is he a religious man, we're told he's a ruler of the Jews, which is a political designation, meaning he is politically influential. He's politically powerful. Ruler of the Jews would be comparable to saying he's a United States senator or United States Congressman. So Nicodemus is both politically influential and powerful. He has authority, and he's a religious man. But it says the same came to Jesus by night. Now, we're not told why he came by night, but I think common sense would tell us that he didn't want any of his powerful friends and peers among the Pharisees or among the other political rulers to know that he was curious about Jesus of Nazareth. He came to Jesus by night. By the time that we finish the gospel narratives, we're going to learn that Nicodemus and one other powerful man, a wealthy man named Joseph of Arimathea, are secret disciples of Jesus. I'm glad they're disciples. I just wish they had been public disciples, confessing disciples, and not secret disciples, but at least they believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. Nicodemus, though, on this occasion, is intrigued by Jesus. He's curious about Jesus. And listen to what he says. He said unto him, Rabbi, which is a title of respect, it means teacher. We know, notice the word we. It suggests to us that he had other Pharisees in his peer group that concurred with him. We know that thou art a teacher come from God. And we know that you're different, is what he's saying. We see evidence that you are a godly man and that God has gifted you. And the evidence that they saw is in this expression, for no man can do the miracles which thou doest except God be with him. Now, interestingly, we're in what chapter? John chapter 3. In the previous chapter, John chapter 2, we read that this first miracle that Jesus did is turning water into wine at the wedding feast in Cana of Galilee. Interestingly, as far as we know, Jesus has only done one miracle by the time John chapter 3 arises. But the news of that miracle had made the rounds to such an extent that Nicodemus wants to know more about Jesus. And I want you to notice what Jesus said to him in verse 3. Jesus answered and said unto him, thank you for the compliment. Is that what he said? We know that you're a teacher come from God because of all these miracles you do. A demonic teacher, a self-styled self, you know, like Napoleon who crowned himself king, somebody who ordained himself and just took it up on his own, couldn't do the things that you're doing. Nicodemus is telling Jesus that he has great esteem for him. And Jesus doesn't even recognize or countenance the compliment. Instead, Jesus says, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You talk about a doctrinal or theological point. Jesus goes straight to theology. This man is a religious leader. He's a political ruler. He comes to Jesus, no doubt, with flattery, basically, complimenting Jesus. Jesus does not respond to the flattery. Instead, Jesus says the new birth is a necessity. It's absolutely essential, even for a powerful, wealthy, political leader, even for a religious Pharisee who is very specific and meticulous about keeping the law, except a man be born again. Notice the word except. That is, this is the only hope for sinners. Unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. May I suggest that many of our friends in religious circles have this right opposite. Their position is, in many respects, unless you see the kingdom, you can't be born again. In other words, you've got to hear the gospel. You've got to see the kingdom. You've got to understand who Jesus is. You know, the ABCs of free will theology. A, you must admit that you're a sinner. That's the letter A, admit or acknowledge. Then you must believe, that's B, in Jesus Christ, and then you must confess him, that's C, publicly. ABCs, that's the plan of salvation. So you've got to see the kingdom. Admit you're a sinner, believe in Jesus, and make confession of him with your mouth unto salvation, and then you will be born again. Their position is you've got to see the kingdom in order to be born again. Jesus said the very opposite of that. Unless you're born again, you can't even see the kingdom. Yeah. of God. The point is, dear friends, that understanding the truth of the gospel, believing in Jesus Christ, serving God in a way that glorifies Him, being a blessing to God's people, experiencing life in the kingdom of God, in this world, as well as going to heaven when you die, it all depends upon the new birth, upon being born again. And the new birth is necessary for powerful, wealthy, religious leaders like Nicodemus, as well as for normal, average, common people like me, and like most of us here tonight. The new birth is a necessity. Now, why is the new birth so necessary? You must be born again. Why is it so necessary that a person be born again? Because our first birth has left us in trouble.
Yeah.
Our first birth, my friends, is a birth in trespasses and in sins. David said it like this in the 51st Psalm, and the 5th verse, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive."
Amen.
David is teaching there that we're all Adam multiplied, that children bear the nature of their parents. And when Adam sinned in the Garden of Eden, he plunged himself and his entire posterity, the entire human family, into a state of corruption and alienation from God.
Amen.
Romans chapter 5, verse 12 says, "Wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned." Who is that one man? That one man is Adam. And because of Adam's transgression, my friends, even your lovely, sweet grandchildren are born sinners. Somebody says, "Well, my grandchildren are an exception to this." Well, your children weren't an exception, were they? You say, "No, I wish I'd have my grandchildren first." But your grandchildren came from your children. And the fact is that we can't escape the fact. You say, "Brother Gowens, if every human being is a sinner and Jesus was a man, wasn't he a sinner?" No, he was virgin born. And the virgin birth of Jesus means he escaped the natural pollution of the human bloodline. He was conceived by the Holy Ghost in the womb of the Jewish Virgin Mary. The doctrine of the virgin birth is important. The rest of us, though, my friends, are, here's a theological term, messed up. Big time. We are really messed up. We come to this world, Psalm 58:3 says, as soon as they be born, speaking lies. It's not long before we start practicing deception. Even sweet little babies have that self-centered, self-aggrandizing attitude that would be murderous if they weren't so little and so helpless. It's a fact that we're all sinners by nature. And that means, as Ephesians chapter 2 tells us in verse 3, that we're children of wrath, even as others. It is a fact that left in our first birth, we would all experience eternal judgment. The wrath of God would abide upon me and upon you, were it not that I could start over with a new birth. Have you ever wished that you could go back and start over, maybe with a project? You've had a project of maybe building a shed in your backyard, and you didn't take the time to read the directions. I'm telling on myself. And you just jumped right in and thought, "I can do this. This looks simple as pie." And you started nailing boards together, and you made several cuts, and then had to go back to the lumber yard to buy more lumber because you'd ruined the pieces that you bought the first time. And anyway, you finally get it together, and you think, "Well, There it is. It's not much to look at, but if I could start over, I would do things differently. Have you ever wanted to start over in a relationship? But we just need to go back and start over. You know, it's an interesting feature of the Jewish economy that God built in to the life of Israel in the Old Testament every 50 years, a new beginning, a fresh start. It's called the Year of Jubilee. And I think sometimes our lives get so tangled and complicated that we need to just step back and say, let's blow the trumpet, declare a year of Jubilee. Let's have a fresh start. Let's go back to the beginning. Let's pretend that we're starting. Let's just start over. But you know, the fact is we can't, in literal terms, start over with life, right? I could. I would do some things differently, wouldn't you?
Yes.
But you know, it's futile to live with vain regret because you can't change the past. But you say, oh, if I just had a new beginning, a fresh start, a new birth, a rebirth. Well, Jesus says that that's exactly what happens in a person's life whose first birth is marred by sin and depravity. He's given a new beginning. There's a new creation that takes place. That word created is used to talk about the doctrine of regeneration in Ephesians 2:10. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. It's used in 2 Corinthians 5:17 when he says, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creature. A creature is the product of a creator. It's a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. It's the ultimate new beginning, the ultimate fresh start. And it means, if you've been born again, it means that a miracle has happened in your life. Because it is miraculous. The word from again, if you have a good margin, marginal reference in your Bible, may be flagged, and the margin reads from above. This is something vertical, not biological. It's not horizontal. It doesn't come from flesh. You can't get it from mother, father, brother, sister, neighbor, or friend. This is flesh only reproduces flesh. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. He tells us that here, right?
Yes.
That which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. I want to tell you that at some point in the life of every one of God's elect, between the moment of conception and when you breathe your last breath in death, at some point, God will find every one of his children, and they will be given a new birth in which there is, if you please, a renewal of the Holy Ghost. There's a cleansing that takes place in the heart in which the blood that Christ shed on the cross for your legal justification is actually personally and vitally applied to your soul. Something miraculous happens in your inward man, and the Holy Spirit comes to live inside of you to indwell your heart. According to Romans chapter 8, if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, the indwelling of the Holy Ghost. Colossians 1:27 describes it as Christ in you, the hope of glory. I'm telling you, dear friends, that if you never have another miracle happen in your life, you've already had one, the greatest one, when you were born of the Spirit, because it is something supernatural, something miraculous, and it is an absolute necessity if anyone will see God's face in peace. You must be born again. It's crucial because our first birth has left us aliens from God. Now, the second word must is in the 13th or 14th verse. After this conversation with Nicodemus about the new birth, Jesus says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. He talked about the necessity of regeneration. Now he talks about the necessity the cross. Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me." And I'm sure that he dreaded the moment of abandonment when the Father, in his, as a man, as any of us would get nervous and would dread a moment of great agony and suffering when to know that the Father would turn his back, forsake him. You know, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? To know that the wrath of God would abide upon him, the punishment due to every one of his children, you and me, and all of his people in all ages of time, our sins of omission and sins of commission. I know that as Jesus anticipated the hour in which he would experience divine judgment that was due to those sins in our stead, I'm sure he dreaded the cross and he prayed, "If it be possible, let this cup pass. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." The fact is, however, dear friends, the cross could not be escaped. And he prayed on another occasion, John 12:26, "Father, the hour is come, and now is my soul troubled. What should I say?" And he gives two options. "Father, save me from this hour." He says, "I could pray, Father, get me out of this trouble." And he says, "But for this cause came I unto this hour, Father, glorify thy name." And a voice came from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." By the way, those are the two prayers you can pray in a time of crisis. Lord, get me out of this trouble. Or Lord, take me through it and glorify your name in the process. Well, Jesus says, as he anticipates the cross, that it is really unavoidable. "Even so must the Son of Man be lifted up." The cross, my beloved, was absolutely necessary. You see this thought again in Matthew 16:21 about the necessity of the cross. In fact, he even uses the verb must, indicating a logical necessity. It has to happen. Matthew 16:21, "From that time forth, Jesus began to show unto his disciples how that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day." You see it in Acts 17:3 when Paul at the city of Thessalonica goes into the Jewish synagogue and he begins to reason with them as his manner was out of the scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. Then you see that word again in Luke 24:7, when the angel at the empty tomb says to the disciples, "The Son of Man," he says, "remember that he, while when he was yet in Galilee, he said, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.'" And they remembered his words. I want to say that the cross was absolutely necessary to your redemption. Just as the work of the Holy Spirit is absolutely necessary to apply Christ's merit to your heart in a cleansing efficacy and renewing power that will fit you for heaven, so that as soon as your mortal body dies, at that moment your soul and spirit is cleansed, it's ready to go to heaven. It's been created anew. It's been created in righteousness and true holiness. Just as the new birth is absolutely essential, so the crucifixion of Jesus on the cross was absolutely necessary for at least three reasons. First, because the Old Testament prophesied it would happen. Matthew 26, 53, we read these words. Jesus says, "Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels?" Now, I've heard different ideas as to how much a legion consisted of. I personally think that it's about 6,000. So 12 legions would be 72,000 angels. He said, "I could offer a prayer right now, and God the Father would dispatch 72,000 angels from heaven to my side." You know, those angels were waiting already. They were perplexed that the Son of God from all eternity past was being so maligned and abused and scoffed at and persecuted and was going to the cross. Jesus says, "I could pray and those angels would be at my side in a heartbeat, but how then shall the scriptures be fulfilled?" That thus it must be. Indeed, my friends, the Old Testament scriptures had predicted and prophesied that Jesus, the Son of God, would suffer, bleed, and die on the cross. One of those prophecies is the 22nd Psalm, a messianic psalm in which the first 16 verses describe crucifixion of 1,000 years before the Roman Empire invented the idea. It says, "They pierced my hands and my feet," and that psalm begins by saying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" By the way, you will never have to pray that prayer because Jesus prayed it in your place.
Yeah.
About the moment you say, "God, why have you forsaken me?" I want you to remember, he will never forsake you. He will never leave nor forsake one of his children because Jesus was abandoned in your place, and that's what hell would have been in our lives. Yeah. You've heard somebody say, "This is a God-forsaken place." I used to live in New Mexico. I had a friend that asked me, that told me, said, "My wife and I are going to New Mexico for vacation." I thought, man, that should be my first sign that he's not real smart. But anyway, "We're going to New Mexico for vacation." He says, "What's it like?" I said, "It's like going to the beach without any water." I mean, it's dry, arid. If you like cacti, and if you like lizards and horned toads and all sorts of creepy and scorpions, then that's great. Enjoy yourself. Knock yourself out. I used to live there. They call it the land of enchantment. But anyway, I hope nobody ever hears this. Some of my friends in New Mexico. There are parts of it that are pretty. Okay, yeah. But anyway, I start down the path chasing a rabbit of foolishness, and look, I lose my train of thought. But anyway, I used to live in New Mexico, and I have to tell you, let's see, what was I to say? Well, I'm getting it, John. I can't remember.
God-forsaken place.
Yeah, God-forsaken place. Thank you. You see if I've got any money. there is no such place on this earth that is completely abandoned by God.
Right?
He's omnipresent. You can't flee from his presence. He's everywhere, present, nowhere absent. And if I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. And if I make my bed in hell, that thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning, like the sun appears to fly from one horizon to the other and fly to the uttermost parts of the sea, though times and circumstances and seasons change, even there thy hand shall lead me, thy right hand shall uphold me. God is there. You will never find a place in this world that is completely devoid. Even the wicked are recipients of God's benevolence. I didn't say of his love, but of his kindness. It rains on the just, but the unjust have to fend for themselves, right? Now, they get the benefits of rain as well. They breathe his air. They drink his water. They enjoy the benefits of a tasty Washington Delicious Apple or a good meal. They enjoy the comforts of a roaring fire on a cold winter's night. Now, they don't return the glory to God for it. But you see, they are beneficiaries of God's goodness. He's good to all.
Yes.
And his tender mercies are over all of his works. But hell is a place of ultimate God forsakenness.
Amen.
For God is not that where there's no relief. No relief. Now, you know, if you've had crippling pain, chronic pain, and even periodically through analgesics or through some kind of therapy, you can get some relief for a little while, right? But the wicked man in Luke 16, he said that I'm tormented in this flame, and there was no relief. Jesus endured that without getting into too much detail on your behalf and mine, because that's what I deserved. That's what you deserved. He was forsaken by God. God forsaken us. Why is it necessary that Jesus go to the cross? Because the Old Testament prophesied of it, and God cannot lie. Because of the holiness of God. I love that the answer to that question in Psalm 22, why hast thou forsaken me? Verse 3 says, but thou art holy. You know the reason the cross was necessary? Because God is too holy to countenance sin. He can't just turn his head away and pretend it never happened. Justice must be served. I want to tell you, God never dispenses grace at the expense of his justice. Somebody says, God, it's God's job to forgive. No, it's not unless the law is satisfied. I'll tell you, when God extended mercy to sinners like us, it was because Jesus had satisfied the legal demands of God's law on the cross of Calvary. And therefore, righteousness, that's justice, and peace are met together. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. You have both the satisfaction of God's just law and the extension of mercy to sinful men and women, boys and girls, at the cross through Jesus Christ. I'll tell you one other reason the cross was necessary, because of the everlasting covenant. In Luke 24:26, we read, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And that word ought means an obligation, to owe, O-W-E. Now, the cross was not just a good idea, or maybe it can help a little. It was absolutely essential. Without the substitutionary atonement of Jesus Christ, a whole lot of us would be banished from the presence of God forever. The cross was necessary. Real quickly, John 3:30. John the Baptist says, when his disciples come to him and say, Master, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him, and what they're saying is, he's stealing your crowd. And you know, preachers get jealous over another preacher stealing their crowd. I don't like it. I love what Elder Cecil Darty said one time, the late Elder C.E. Darty from Georgia. He's a Methodist pastor, told him, said, Mr. Darty, I want you to stop stealing my members. Brother Cecil said, I don't want your members. I want my members you've got. They need to believe the truth. Well, John the Baptist is approached by his disciples saying, his crowd is growing and yours is shrinking. And I love John's humble, servant-hearted response when he says, you yourselves bear me witness that I said, I'm not the Christ, but I'm sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but I'm just the best man at the wedding, the friend of the bridegroom, that standeth by and heareth him and rejoices because of the bridegroom's voice. Then he says this, he must increase, and I must decrease. My beloved, the necessity of glorifying the Lord in your life and mine, that is a necessity, isn't it?
Yes.
He must increase. The necessity of Christ's preeminence. I love a quote by Arthur W. Pink, who said that growing in grace is like the growth of a cow's tail. The more it grows, the closer it gets to the ground. And when God's children grow, the more humble and less self-assured and more willing to admit my weakness and my total insufficiency and inadequacy, the more that will be evident in our lives. In other words, my beloved, I must decrease, but he must increase. George Whitefield said near the end of his life, let the name of George Whitefield perish, so long as the name of Jesus Christ is exalted. All glory goes to God, right?
Yes.
Not to me, not to Brother Richie, Brother Stephen, these other brethren here tonight, not to you, not to our grandparents that are buried in the cemetery. All glory goes to God. He that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord.
Amen.
He must increase. And may his glory and his beauty grow more and more in your mind and heart the further you go down the path of Christian discipleship. And the more you grow, may you see him as greater and lovelier and more excellent and sweeter as the years go by. Finally, John 4, Jesus says to the Samaritan woman at the well, as they're discussing the subject of worship, they that worship the Father must worship him in spirit and in truth. The necessity of the new birth, the necessity of redemption by Christ on the cross, the necessity of Christ's glory, the necessity of true worship. I want to tell you, dear friends, everything that calls itself worship is not true worship.
Amen.
The hour is coming in which the true worshipers, now doesn't the adjective true suggest that there is such thing as false worship? I want to be a true worshiper. And how do you worship God in sincerity? How do you worship truly? They must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, I think no doubt that means that we need the Holy Spirit, doesn't it? Worship him in spirit. And I need the Spirit to preach. You need the Spirit to hear. We should pray that the Holy Spirit would be showered all around when we gather together to worship. We need a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit, not because he has lost his influence, but because we've often quenched and grieved the Spirit. And we need to repent so that the church would revive in these days. But I think that verse also may mean that if you're going to worship God, it involves more than just lip service.
Amen.
And going through the formality and mechanically say, well, I went to church, that means I've worshiped. No, your heart needs to be involved.
Amen.
They that worship the Father must worship him in spirit, must be genuine, it must come from the heart, and in truth. And that is just as essential as the right attitude and the presence of the Holy Spirit, the truth. God has given us his truth. He said, where is it, Brother Michael? Thy word is truth. So let's preach the word. Let's stand for the old paths. Let's proclaim the good news of Christ crucified. Because, my friends, he is the way, the truth, and the life. The foremost of John chapters 3 and 4. I hope some of these thoughts have been edified. God bless you. Thank you.